Hello, women made in the image of God. Today we're back with another Bible in a Year video, and today we get to read Psalm 50 through 52, and we get to read Acts 27, 1 through 26. So let's pray and read the word. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word, for it is a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. It is the way that you sanctify us, Lord, the way that you encourage us, the way that you exhort us, the way that you comfort us, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just thank you so much, Lord. May we never take your word for granted, but cherish it, because we cherish you, Lord. Please help us to store up your words in our hearts today so that we might not sin against you, but that we would grow in conformity to you because of your great love, Lord, with which you have loved us. Lord, help us to now love you in response to your great love and to love our neighbor as we are so quick to be so concerned with ourselves. Lord, help us to rather put our neighbor's needs before our own, to share the gospel with them, to fight against self-preservation and to put that to death, and instead to look to glorify you, God, that and to walk in the good works that you prepared beforehand that we should do them. That people would see you, Jesus, and glorify you as a result of that. Lord, thank you for today. May you be glorified in us throughout this day, and would you be putting your words into our hearts and minds as we read today. Would you teach us your ways, O Lord? Please, precious Holy Spirit, would you please teach us today as we read the text. In Jesus' name, amen. Alright, open up in your Bibles to Psalm 50. Psalm 50.
Psalm 50. A Psalm of Asaph.
The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes. He does not keep silence. Before him is a devouring fire, around him a mighty tempest. He calls to the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people.
Gather to me, my faithful ones, who made a covenant with me.
Devouring fire. Our God comes. He does not keep silence. Before him is a devouring fire, around him a mighty tempest. He calls to the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people.
Gather to me, my faithful ones, who made a covenant with me by sacrifice.
The heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge. Selah. Hear, O my people, and I will speak. O Israel, I will testify against you. I am God, your God. Not for your sacrifices do I rebuke you. Your burnt offerings are continually before me. I will not accept a bull from your house or goats from your folds. For every beast of the forest is mine, the cattle on a thousand hills. I know all the birds of the hills, and all that moves in the field is mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you. For the world and its fullness are mine. Do I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving, and perform your vows to the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me. But to the wicked, God says, what right have you to recite my statutes or take my covenant on your lips? For you hate discipline, and you cast my words behind you. If you see a thief, you are pleased with him, and you keep company with adulterers. You give your mouth free rein for evil, and your tongue frames deceit. You sit and speak against your brother. You slander your own mother's son. These things you have done, and I have been silent. You thought that I was one like yourself. But now I rebuke you and lay the charge before you. Mark this, then, you who forget God, lest I tear you apart and there be none to deliver. The one who offers thanksgiving as his sacrifice glorifies me. To one who orders his way rightly, I will show the salvation of God.
Psalm 51. To the choir master, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet went to him after he had gone into Bathsheba.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words, and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then will you delight in right sacrifices, in burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar.
Psalm 52. To the choir master, a masculine of David, when Doeg the Edomite came and told Saul, David has come to the house of Ahimelech.
Why do you boast of evil, O mighty man? The steadfast love of God endures all the day. Your tongue plots destruction like a sharp razor, you worker of deceit. You love evil more than good, and lying more than speaking what is right. Selah. You love all words that devour, O deceitful tongue. But God will break you down forever. He will snatch and tear you from your tent. He will uproot you from the land of the living. Selah. The righteous shall see and fear, and shall laugh at him, saying,
See the man who would not make God his refuge, but trusted in the abundance of his riches, and sought refuge in his own destruction.
But I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I trust in the steadfast love of God forever and ever. I will thank you forever, because you have done it. I will wait for your name, for it is good, in the presence of the godly.
Psalm 53. To the choir man.
Wow, wow, wow. I love this psalm so much. So 50, Psalm 50. What a beautiful psalm. Speaks so much of who God is, and I love that. You see direct quotes from God. It is God's word, so it's already God speaking. In the sense that it's his inspired word, but you know what I'm saying, and I just love it. I really liked this chapter. Yeah. There's so much in it. Let's start at the top. The Lord is mighty. God, the Lord, God Yahweh, the great I am. And this is shown throughout the psalm, the mightiness of the Lord, that he speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. He calls of the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people. He's mighty over all. Our God comes. He does not keep silence. Before him is a devouring fire. Around him a mighty tempest. He's so cool. He's so holy. So beautiful, amazing, wonderful. Words can't capture how amazing God is. Everything belongs to him. Everything. Every beast, if the forest is mine, the cattle on 1,000 hills. For the world and its fullness are mine. Yep, that's who God is. He's so mighty. And I liked this a lot. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. It just reminds me of the fact that God is beautiful. He is the perfection of beauty. And he shines. Shines forth. So cool. So true. And it reminds me of in Revelation how it speaks of that we won't have a sun anymore, like a sunshine, you know? We'll have God as our light. That is so cool. He's so cool. Bright light. He's our light. Our God, he does not keep silence. Before him is a devouring fire, around him a mighty tempest. I love this. Gather to me my faithful ones who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. This reminds me of pointing forward to in Christ, the ones who Christ sacrificed himself for, who are part of his new covenant. So I'm thinking of the new covenant and how he is faithful to us, and now he gives us the Holy Spirit and a new heart that we can be faithful to him. He makes us faithful ones. He gives us the fruit of the Spirit that is faithfulness. And thanks be to God for that, because without him we are not faithful. And as Christians, we still fall short, but you are to Christ. He keeps you. So, yeah. Anyways, oh my people, I am your God. It's just beautiful the way that he speaks to his people. And this verse, I love this. Love this verse 15 especially. But yes, it goes. It's a sentence, so shouldn't cut him off. So it's offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving, and perform your vows to the Most High. So God is the Most High. And he does not. You see the fact that the blood sacrifices in the Old Testament, they're all pointing towards Christ's ultimate sacrifice. And what the Lord wants from us is just thanksgiving, you know, to delight in him, to rejoice in him. And that's what makes us happy too, is when thankfulness. I mean, even the world, in a dumb way, that's kind of mean, but like, in a dumb way, they will practice thankfulness and so forth. But it's not. They don't. They're just being thankful in general, but they're not directing their thankfulness to God. But just the effects of being thankful for what you have been given, and most of all, to be thankful for God. To God, all of it should be directed towards God. When we don't give him thanks, we're just fools. And also, we're forgetting joy. Joy comes from expressing thanks back to him. Thankful for all that he's done. That's a part of where joy comes from. But anyways, yeah, like delighting in him and what he's done. And following him. Not just lip service, but actually, like, walking it out. I love this verse, and he's speaking to his people, and call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me. Like, it's such a beautiful promise to hold to. Something to write on your heart right here. I mean, you should write this whole chapter on your heart, but specifically, so good. And call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver. And call upon me in the day of trouble, I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me. Amen. Yes. This reminds me also of how we can share our testimony of how the Lord has delivered us in the biggest thing, which is from death and sin and death. Be sharing our testimony and sharing the gospel through sharing our testimony. Pointing to Jesus Christ and him crucified. And also in the different things that the Lord does throughout our life. You know, for example, like, if you could have, like, okay, I'm, like, rambling. Sorry, I'm going to get us to the notes soon here. Let me fast forward myself. But yeah, to glorify him, to speak of his goodness. His mercies. Then God goes to rebuke the wicked, and he still exhorts them to turn back to God, which is awesome. Even then, he's inviting. Yeah, so I love that. And then this rebuke is huge. You thought that I was one like yourself, but now I rebuke you and lay the charge before you. This is what the modern church, quote-unquote church, is like often at times too, is where they just want to make God like them rather than seeing who God is in his word. And repent! Mark this then, you who forget God, lest I tear you apart and there be none to deliver. One who offers sacrifices, thanksgiving as his sacrifice, glorifies me. To one who orders his way rightly, I will show the salvation of God. Yeah. Love God, live it out. And the power of the Spirit now, because we can't do it on our own. And yeah, we need Jesus. Psalm 51. Beautiful psalm. I could spend forever on this, but I love how the psalmist is writing depending, David is crying out to God for his mercy according to his steadfast love, according to his abundant mercy. That is our God. He is steadfast love, and he is abundant in mercy. In Christ, ultimately, he does. For all those who come to him in true repentance and faith, he has died for their sins. Christ died for sinners so that we could have this reality. It's like, thank you, Jesus. Yeah, Jesus died for David too. So, yeah. And this is crucial. Like, your sin is first and foremost against God. Yeah. I love that. Amen. And yeah, just all of this is so good to pray and to please meditate on this. And yeah, it's so good. Cry out to God in repentance. And I love this. He wants to do this. This is what we do now. When the Lord saves us, we go tell people, just like we saw back here. We go tell people. And it brings us joy to do that too. But yeah, good prayer to pray right here. O Lord, open my lips and my mouth will declare your praise. Amen. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite, O God, you will not despise. Amen. Godly grief, he will not despise. That's what the Lord wants. And that's what the Lord gives to his people. So good. And Psalm 52, so good. So good. Don't boast. Why do you boast, O mighty of evil, mighty man? We can learn that these are things that God does not like, verses 2 through 3. And verse 1, and this is who God is. God will rescue, and he will judge, because he is the steadfast love of God. God of love, he is holy and righteous, and he has set a day when he will judge. He will condemn all wickedness, because he is a God of love. God is love, and therefore he must judge what is not love, what is wicked, what is evil. Yeah. Forever. This reminds me of hell. Hell is eternal. Yeah. God is a just God. See the man who would not make God his refuge, but trusted in the abundance of his riches and sought refuge in his own destruction. So don't be someone that God ultimately judges, and cry out to the lost, that they might seek God, to have God as their refuge, that they would seek refuge in Christ rather than their own, rather than being destroyed by, than their trust in the Lord. But yeah, it's good. We be with God, and you'll be like a green olive tree, thriving in the Lord, trust in the steadfast love of God forever and ever. Amen. Thank him because he has done it. This is not you being like, I'm so righteous. It's God is the one who has saved you. His name is good. Yeah. Be with God. Also with the church. It reminded me of the importance of being with the church. But yeah, so Psalm 50 through 52, let's hit those Reformation Study notes.
Reformation Study Bible Notes, R.C. Sproul. Psalm 50, 52, P.S. 50. This psalm has a prophetic cast, since a large part of it is composed of two oracles of the Lord, one spoken to the righteous and the other against the wicked. The psalm places special focus on the need to give thanks, V.V. 14, 15, 22, 23, as it calls the covenant people to renew their relationship with the Lord, V.V. 1, 6. By returning to grateful worship, BV 7:15, and true obedience, BV 16:23. With regard to the title, see introduction, author. B's 51:6, These verses call the covenant people to renew their relationship with the Lord. 51, the Mighty One, God the Lord. The psalm opens impressively with three divine names. The third is God's covenant name, conventionally translated with the word Lord in small capital letters. In Hebrew, it is four consonants called the tetragrammaton, and pronounced Yahweh by contemporary scholars, though that pronunciation is not certain. CX 3:13-15, and notes, rising of the sun to its setting. From east to west, God addresses the whole earth. 52 Zion, the location of the temple, the place God has chosen to make his presence known. C2:6, shines forth. The language indicates a theophany, a visual self-revelation of God. God's presence is manifest at his temple in Jerusalem. C-Dut. 33. Devouring fire. Devouring fire. God's theophany, devouring fire, is often accompanied by powerful and dangerous forces, especially when he speaks in judgment. Ix 19:24-1:55 covenant with me by sacrifice. A covenant is a solemn agreement between persons. Here, as in most places, it signifies the bond between God and his people. However, since man is sinful, this relationship must be accompanied by sacrifice, representing the punishment for sin. 56 heavens. Possibly a poetic way of referring to the inhabitants of heaven, the angels, otherwise, the glory of the inanimate, created heavens. 57:15. These verses call the covenant people to grateful worship. 57 testify. This legal terminology is used because covenants were legal instruments that were similar to contracts or treaties. When there was some disruption in the people's faithfulness, they were often put on trial by the Lord, or one of his prophets, Mice. 61:8-58. Not for your sacrifices do I rebuke you. Indicates that the people's problem was not observance of the sacrificial rites. They were faithful to do them, but they apparently misunderstood their significance. 59 will not accept. The people of the surrounding nations thought that their gods ate the sacrifices offered to them and grew hungry when deprived. In the Gilgamesh epic, the goddess Ishtar bemoans the lack of sacrifices that resulted in her god-sized hunger. 50:10, every beast of the forest. God affirms that he created and owns all the creatures of the world. Here in 13:14, do I eat the flesh of bulls? This rhetorical question makes clear that the Lord neither eats the sacrifices, nor is he satisfied with them apart from sincere commitment and thanksgiving. 16:23, these verses call the covenant people to true obedience. 16, wicked. The wicked people within the professing covenant community, since they know God's law. Recite. Maybe a reference to a covenant renewal ceremony in which the covenant community together recites the law and reaffirms its intention to keep it. Deut. 31:9-11. 0:17, hate, discipline. A sure sign of a fool. Prov. 1:7. 0:18-19. The psalmist cites the 7th, 8th, and 9th commandments. 50:21. I have been silent. God's silence is frequently taken by the wicked as a sign that he doesn't care if they sin. 50:22. Lest I tear you apart. God insists on obedience from the wicked hypocrites, or they will meet a fearful end. P.S. 51. A uniquely powerful statement of the depths of sin and the heights of repentance. It is the most striking of the prayers of penitence. Introduction to P.S. 6. A type of lament. This psalm exposes the need that results from moral failures. Everyone has two needs, reconciliation, vv. 1-9, and transformation, vv. 10-19. 51:1-9, these verses show the need for reconciliation. 51:1, according to your steadfast love, David was guilty of a great sin in the matter of Uriah and Bathsheba, 2 Sam. 11. David pleads for God's mercy in keeping with his promised love for his people. Human depravity. A common point of debate among theologians focuses on the question, are human beings basically good or basically evil? The hinge upon which the argument turns is the word basically. It is a virtual universal consensus that nobody is perfect. We accept the maxim to err is human. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Despite this verdict on human shortcomings, the idea persists in our humanistically dominated culture that sin is something peripheral or tangential to our nature. Indeed, we are flawed by sin. Our moral records exhibit blemishes, but somehow we think that our evil deeds reside at the rim or edge of our character and never penetrate to the core. Basically, it is assumed people are inherently good. But if we lift our gaze to the ultimate standard of goodness, the holy character of God, we realize that what appears to be a basic goodness on an earthly level is corrupt to the core. The Bible teaches the total depravity of the human race. Total depravity means radical corruption. We must be careful to note the difference between total depravity and utter depravity. To be utterly depraved is to be as wicked as one could possibly be. Hitler was extremely depraved, but he could have been worse than he was. I am a sinner. Yet I could sin more often and more severely than I actually do. I am not utterly depraved, but I am totally depraved. For total depravity means that I and everyone else are depraved or corrupt in the totality of our being. There is no part of us that is left untouched by sin. Our minds, our wills, and our bodies are affected by evil. We speak sinful words, do sinful deeds, have impure thoughts. Our very bodies suffer from the ravages of sin. Perhaps radical corruption is a better term to describe our fallen condition than total depravity. I am using the word radical not so much to mean extreme, but to lean more heavily on its original meaning. Radical comes from the Latin word for root, or core. Our problem with sin is that it is rooted in the core of our being. It permeates our hearts. It is because sin is at our core, and not merely at the exterior of our lives, that the Bible says. None is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside, together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Romans 3:10-12. It is because of this condition that the verdict of Scripture is heard. We are dead in trespasses and sins. Ephesians 2:1. We are sold under sin. Romans 7:14. We are captive to the law of sin. Romans 7:23. And are by nature children of wrath. Ephesians 2:3. Only by the quickening power of the Holy Spirit may we be brought out of this state of spiritual death. It is God who makes us alive as we become his craftsmanship. Ephesians 2:1-10. Mercy. God's forgiveness of sinners is the result of his mercy. Sinners deserve death, but he gives life. 51:2. Wash. The word means specifically to wash clothes. The psalmist's iniquity is like filthy clothes that need to be laundered. 51. You only. David committed adultery with Bathsheba and sent her husband to his death. How can he say he sinned against God only? This is an example of hyperbole, 16:2 note, the point being that David's sin was ultimately, not exclusively, against God. Rebellion against God was the root of his sin, and his crime injured people who belonged to God and transgressed a social order created by God, justified, blameless. David recognized that God's anger against him was just. This verse is cited by Paul in Rom 3:4. 51:5 brought forth in iniquity. The Bible clearly teaches that children are sinners. They are not born innocent and only later become sinners. Children too need God's salvation. See theological note, human depravity. 51:6 inward being, the secret heart. Truth and wisdom at the center of one's being. 51:7 with hyssop, the allusion is to Lev 14:6-7, where the cleansing of a leper is described. Wash me. This may be an allusion to Num 19:19, where instructions are given for ritual washing after contact with a dead person. On the need for washing the heart, see theological note, legalism, on P1D 713. 51:8-19. These verses show the need for transformation. 51:10 create. The verb is the same one used at General 1 for the creation of the world, a verb that focuses on the newness of the thing created. The psalmist knows that the redirection of his desires and thoughts can come about only through the intervention of God. See theological note, repentance, on P 1964. 51:11 Holy Spirit. The OT does not make a full disclosure of the personhood of the Holy Spirit. David understands that his spiritual well-being depends on God's presence with him. He fears that the spirit of anointing for kingship may be taken away from him, as the spirit was taken from Saul, 1 Sam 16:14. See theological note, the personality of the Holy Spirit, on P 1889. 1:12 joy of your salvation. David suffered from a spiritual dullness that led to moral bankruptcy. To prevent such disaster in the future, he prays for joy. 51:13 teach transgressors your ways. If forgiven, David promises to use his life to help others find forgiveness. See PS 32. 1:14 sing aloud of your righteousness. David has already spoken of God's justice in condemning sin. Phase 4. Now, the same justice overcomes sin and condemnation through grace, as explained in Rom 3:21-26 and epitomized in 1 John 1:1-9. 51:16 You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. See 59. The Bible values heartfelt obedience above outward religious conformity. 46:8 Mike 6:6-8. As V19 shows, this does not condemn sacrifices as such. 1:18-19 The restoration of the king leads to blessing for the people. P.S. 52 This psalm, like P.S. 49, is an instructional poem that expresses confidence in the Lord, like a psalm of trust, pronounces judgment on the wicked, like a lament, and uses wisdom language. The psalm focuses on the question of personal security. Will it be found in oneself, V 1:7, or in God, V 8:9? 52, title. The historical title refers to the event recorded in 1 Sam 22:6-23. In effect, the title identifies Doeg with the boastful, wicked man and David with the righteous psalmist. However, the psalm itself is not so specific, and continues to be immediately relevant to the people of God. 52:1. These verses ask about the wisdom of finding security in self. 52:1 boast of evil, as if evil deeds will provide all that one needs. Mighty man, a soldier, or warrior. 52:4 devour. More exactly, confused. The wisdom literature consistently teaches that confusion is on the side of the wicked and order on the side of righteousness. 52:6 fear. This verb may seem strange as associated with laughter. The meaning, however, is not fear in the sense of dread, but rather in the sense of reverence and awe. The righteous see the justice of God's judgment against the wicked. 52:7 would not make God his refuge. This man is the opposite of everything the Psalms stand for. Throughout the Psalms, people are urged to find their security in God, not themselves. God is the power behind his people in all their victories, trusted in riches, sought refuge in his own destruction, relied on self for security. 52:8-9. These verses encourage the wisdom of finding security in God. 52:8. Olive tree. Reminiscent of PSS 1:92. Olive trees can live for hundreds of years. I trust in the steadfast love of God. The psalmist found security in God. 52:9. You have done it. The psalmist acknowledges that God, not self, is the source of security. In the presence of the godly, the assurance of the psalmist leads to praise in public worship. See note on 22:22. Acts 27:1-26. Chapter.
Okay, open up in your Bible to Acts 27.
Acts 27. And when it was decided that we should sail for Italy, they delivered Paul and some other prisoners to a centurion of the Augustan cohort named Julius. And embarking in a ship of Adramidium, which was about to sail to the ports along the coast of Asia, we put to sea, accompanied by Aristarchus, a Macedonian from Thessalonica. The next day we put in at Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly and gave him leave to go to his friends and be cared for. And putting out to sea from there, we sailed under the lee of Cyprus, because the winds were against us. And when we had sailed across the open sea along the coast of Cilicia and Pamphylia, we came to Myra in Lycia. There the centurion found a ship of Alexandria sailing for Italy and put us on board. We sailed slowly for a number of days and arrived with difficulty off Cnidus. And as the wind did not allow us to go farther, we sailed under the lee of Crete off Salmone. Coasting along it with difficulty, we came to a place called Fair Havens, near which was the city of Lycia. since much time had passed and the voyage was now dangerous because even the fast was already over, Paul advised them, saying,
"Sirs, I perceive that the voyage will be with injury and much loss, not only of the cargo in the ship, but also of our lives."
But the centurion paid more attention to the pilot and to the owner of the ship than to what Paul said. And because the harbor was not suitable to spend the winter in, the majority decided to put out to sea from there, on the chance that somehow they could reach Phoenix, a harbor of Crete, facing both southwest and northwest, and spend the winter there. Now when the south wind blew gently, supposing that they had obtained their purpose, they weighed anchor and sailed along Crete, close to the shore. But soon a tempestuous wind, called the northeaster, struck down from the land. And when the ship was caught and could not face the wind, we gave way to it and were driven along. Running under the lee of a small island called Kata, we managed with difficulty to secure the ship's boat. After hoisting it up, they used supports to undergird the ship. Then, fearing that they would run aground on the Syrtis, they lowered the gear, and thus they were driven along. Since we were violently storm-tossed, they began the next day to jettison the cargo, and on the third day they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope of our being saved was at last abandoned. Since they had been without food for a long time, Paul stood up among them and said,
"Men, you should have listened to me and not have set sail from Crete and incurred this injury and loss. Yet now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For this very night there stood before me an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I worship. And he said, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand before Caesar. And behold, God has granted you all those who sail with you. So take heart, men, for I have faith in God that it will be exactly as I have been told. But we must run aground on some island.'"
When the 14th night had come, as we were being driven across the Adriatic Sea, about midnight, the sailors suspected that they were nearing land. So they took a sounding and found 20 fathoms. A little farther on, they took a sounding again and found 15 fathoms. And fearing that we might run on the rocks, they let down 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. And as the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship and had lowered the ship's boat into the sea under pretense of laying out anchors from the bow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers,
"Unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved."
Then the soldiers cut away the ropes of the ship's boat and let it go. As day was about to dawn, Paul urged them all to take some food, saying,
"Today is the 14th day that you have continued in suspense and without food, having taken nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take some food, for it will give you strength, for not a hair is to perish from the head of any of you."
And when he had said these things, he took bread, and giving thanks to God in the presence of all, he broke it and began to eat. Then they all were encouraged and ate some food themselves. We were in all 276 persons in the ship, and when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship, throwing out the wheat into the sea. Now when it was day, they did not recognize the land, but they noticed a bay with a beach.
Sorry, I was really into it. I forgot we were supposed to stop at verse 26. The Bible is so cool. But yeah, so take heart, men, for I have faith in God that it will be exactly as I have been told. So based. Love that. I'm actually going to let... I'm going to let Paul take over for the notes. I mean, not Paul, sorry. I'm just thinking about Paul right now because I just love Acts. But yeah, I just love this. This is a good statement to meditate on. We ought to be the same way. So yeah, let's read the notes.
Acts 27:1-26, chapter 27, 27, the Augustan cohort. 600 Syrian soldiers under the governor's direct command. 27, 2, Adramyttium, on the coast between Troas and Pergamum. We put to sea. This chapter is filled with nautical terms and directions, confirming that the author was an eyewitness, as his use of the first-person plural pronoun to refer to Paul's party implies. We, Aristarchus. Paul has at least 2 companions with him. Luke as his physician, Colonel 414, and Aristarchus, 1929, 24. Colonel 410. Philem, 24, from Thessalonica, probably his attendant. His prison epistles mention others who were with him in Rome at some point, as he awaited the emperor's decision on his appeal. Phil, 2:19:30, Colonel 4:7:14, Philem, 23, 24. 27:3 put in at Sidon, an eastern Mediterranean port, today in Lebanon. Paul and Barnabas encourage Christians in this region as they travel to the Council of Apostles and Elders at Jerusalem. 15. 3. So it is natural that Paul has friends in this city. Julius treated Paul kindly. The centurion's respect for his prisoner will lead to the sparing of many lives in the storm at sea to come. BV 31, 32, 42, 43. 27:4 under the lee of Cyprus. That is, close under the eastern point of the island in order to be protected from the westerly winds of the summer and fall. 27:5 coast of Cilicia and Pamphylia. The ship goes up the Syrian coast, past Antioch of Syria, and then west to Myra. In Paul's day, Myra is an important port of call for grain ships sailing between Alexandria and Rome. 2007, 8 fair havens. A port town with a small harbor on the southern coast of Crete exposed to fierce winds from the Mediterranean during the stormy winter months. 27, 9 the fast. The Day of Atonement, Israel's only annual observance that required fasting, occurred in the autumn, late September to mid-October, when weather on the Mediterranean became unpredictable and sea travel precarious. 27, I perceive. Paul's advice is based on experience at sea, Tokor 11:25-26, not divine revelation. The complete disaster that he anticipates will not be completely fulfilled, for by God's grace there will be no loss of life. VV 24:26, 44. 7:11-12 The captain and the owner want to reach the larger and safer harbor of Phoenix about 40 miles, 64 kilometers, to the west, but in going west past Cape Matala, the ship will be exposed to winds from the northwest. 27:16 A small island called Kauda, now called Gozo, this island lies about 20 miles, 32 kilometers, southwest of Crete's western coast. 27:17 Used supports. Because of the danger of violent storms on the Mediterranean, ancient vessels carried ropes that would be tied around the hull sideways in order to strengthen it in an emergency. Lowered the gear, fearing that they might be driven all the way to the Syrtis, a region of sands near modern-day Libya and Tunisia, the sailors lower the sail. The description in Greek could also mean that they lowered a sea anchor to slow the ship down. 7:23 The God to whom I belong. Christians are God's property both by creation, verse 103, and by redemption, 1 A. and 19:20. 27:24 Do not be afraid, Paul. As in earlier crises, the Lord speaks special reassurance to quiet Paul's fears. 18:9-10-23:11 Granted you all with you. In his kindness, God will save everyone on the ship from drowning. 27:26 Some island. The island of Malta, 28:1 south of Sicily.
Those were good notes. Check out this cool map. I just wanted to see what the ESV Study Bible had to say in this passage. Yeah. These are good notes, too. I like these notes. Yeah. I must stand before Caesar. See. Yep. The ultimate reason for Paul's deliverance was his testimony in Rome. Therefore, whereas Jonah's presence on the ship threatened to destroy everyone, Paul's presence assured everyone's deliverance. That's such a good note. I'm so glad we went over here. I like that. I like that. Yeah. That is so true. Yeah, Jonah was a man who was rebelling against God. Paul is a man who is submissive love to the Lord Jesus, following God. And so, yeah, safety for the people around him. In this particular situation. But yeah. Anyways, let's close in prayer. That's all the text for today. Dear Heavenly Father, you are so awesome and so beautiful and so lovely. Lord, we thank you that you are God alone. We thank you that you are the mighty God, the mighty one. You're the Lord, you're Yahweh. Thank you that you are the perfection of beauty and that you shine forth. Lord, thank you that you come and you do not keep silence. You do what you will do. And that before you is a devouring fire and a mighty tempest. Yeah, you're so holy, Lord. The heavens declare your righteousness, and God, you are judge, you are holy. Lord, thank you that every beast of the forest is yours. Everything belongs to you. The cattle on 1,000 hills, the world and the fullness are yours. Lord, may we continually offer sacrifices of thanksgiving to you, Lord. Thanksgiving for the perfect sacrifice that you've accomplished in our place, that it is finished because Jesus died for sinners like us, so that we could come to you in repentance and faith and receive forgiveness of sins. Lord, help us to remember to call upon you in the day of trouble, that you would deliver us and that we would get to glorify you, Lord, and delight in you and tell people of your wonderfulness. Lord, let us not be like the wicked who lie, who thief, who adulterate, who love evil. Let us not be like that, Lord. Please help us, O God. And help us to preach the gospel to the lost, to the wicked, that you would call more to yourself, Lord, according to your perfect will and timing. Lord, help us to not make an idol that looks a lot like you but isn't you. Help us to worship who you truly are, Lord, and not sugarcoat you and not hide any part of you under a basket, for you do not deserve to be hidden, but to be displayed before all in your beauty, Lord. Lord, let us never forget you. And help us to point those who have forgotten you back to you, Lord, that they might know you and glorify you and delight in you. Help us to offer thanksgiving to you, Lord. Help us to order our way rightly according to your word. By the power of your Spirit, help us to delight in your salvation, Lord. When we sin, Lord, when we, like David, run to you, cry out to you, Lord, teach us wisdom, Lord, and help us to delight in truth in our inward being. To be filled with truth in our inward being. Help us to rejoice in the joy of your salvation. Lord, would you uphold us with a willing spirit and restore to us the joy of our salvation. Lord, please help us to come to you in repentance right now for things that we need help with, Lord. And that we have, Lord, forgive us our sins. Cleanse us from our iniquities. Blot out our transgressions. And help us to be more like Christ. Please, Lord. Help us to confess our sins to one another to find a sister to talk to, our pastor, and to pray that we might be healed, Lord. Lord, you are so good. Thank you that the sacrifices of you, God, are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Lord, thank you for making a way for us to be reconciled to you, Christ, once for all. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. Lord, help us not boast in evil. Help us to not plot destruction. Help us to not be a worker of deceit. Help us to not love evil more than good. Help us to not lie. Help us to not use words that devour. Help us to not speak deceitfully. Help us instead, O Lord, to boast in you alone, Jesus. Help us to plot beautiful good works and not destruction. Help us to not be a worker of deceit, but a worker of the truth, Lord. Help us to love good and hate evil. Help us to speak what is right, O Lord. Help us, please, Lord, to not have a deceitful tongue, but to have a truthful tongue, Lord. Help us to use words that build up and not words that tear down. God, help us. Help us to think before we speak, please, Lord. Sanctify us, Lord, please, by your truth. Lord, help us to make you our refuge. Help us to find refuge in you, to trust in you and not in riches, to trust in you and not to seek our own destruction, but to seek life in you, Lord. Let us not be overcome by the desires of this world, but to be consumed by your goodness and the desire to know you, Lord, and the desire to share you and your beauty with others, Lord. Help us to be like a green olive tree in the house of you, God. Help us to trust in your steadfast love, O God, forever and ever. Help us to thank you forever because you have done it, Lord. You're the Savior. You're the Lord. All glory to you, O Lord. Help us to wait for your name, for it is good in the presence of the godly, Lord. Lord, let us be like Paul, clinging to you at all times. Lord, help us to have faith in you and to believe in your word always, clinging to your word. Lord, you're so good. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your gospel. Thank you for you. You're so awesome, Lord. Would you please give us courage to boldly proclaim your gospel? Would you help us to seek to make others glad in you, Lord? Lord, I pray that you would be with us today as we go forth from here. Lord, we love you and we desperately need you every day, every moment. Please fill us with the power and the strength of your precious Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, well, grace and peace. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.